to know more such amazing stories from Indian history, click the bell icon and subscribe to Live History India.
Dr. Ramachandra Guha is one of modern India's preeminent commentators and historians. He has written several books on ecology, the environment, and histories of cricket. He has written biographies and books on politics, and he has also written two magisterial works, Gandhi Before India and India After Gandhi, in which Guha uses Gandhi as a pivot to really go beyond the man and address a country's birth and evolution.
Dr. Guha, welcome to the Making of Modern India and LifeHistoryIndia.com.
Thank you, Sudeep.
Ram, let me begin with a question which might appear strange to you, but you know the thing is that you, besides being a historian and you're a trained economist and an anthropologist, but I mean you describe yourself primarily as a historian now, and justifiably so. But you know you are engaged, you're deeply interested in so many different facets of life. What got you hooked on Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi? Would you like to share that with us?
Yeah, so first of all, I should disavow any claims to being an economist. I have a degree in economics, but that was acquired by passing my exams using the notes of a friend. I have a formal training in sociology, and I think I'm a self-taught historian, so I accept the sociologist and historian and maybe anthropologist, but certainly not economist. Now, of course, as any Indian of my generation, Gandhi was always somewhere in the background. I was born just 10 years after independence. But my, curiously enough, my family admired Nehru more than Gandhi, because they were I come from a family of public servants, committed to the idea of putting their knowledge and their ideas at the service of the community. And of course, my family was also completely secular. You know, there were no distinctions of caste, religion, and even far less discrimination against women than you would find in most Indian households of the time. My interest in Gandhi was relatively late to develop. And it was only after I did a PhD on the Chipko movement and I met some of the leaders of the Chipko movement, who are, of course, had never met Gandhi themselves, but had been animated by his example and had worked closely with his disciples. So one of the leaders of the Chipko movement I worked with was a disciple of Vinoba Bhave. Another was a disciple of Jayaprakash Narayan. And a third, extraordinary woman called Radha Bhatt, who lives in Kausani, was a disciple of an English woman called Catherine Mary Heilman, who came to India in the 1930s and joined Gandhi, adopted the Indian name Sarla Devi, and then worked in the Himalaya nurturing a cadre of social workers. So my first research was sort of on second and third generation disciples of Gandhi. Then I started working on Elwin, and nice of you to mention that book, which is a particular favorite of mine because of the extraordinary life that Elwin himself led. And here was an Englishman who had been shadowed and tracked by Gandhi all his life. He'd come to India as a missionary, left the church, joined Gandhi, then started working with tribal people, where he became disenchanted with Gandhi because of Gandhi's emphasis on celibacy and prohibition. But late in life, he rediscovered Gandhi. And of course, he, unlike the leaders of the Chipko movement, Elwin had known Gandhi at relatively close quarters, had lived in the ashram for a spell of time. And again, unlike the leaders of the Chipko movement and unlike Sarvaya workers in general, did not have an unduly reverential attitude towards Gandhi. He admired him in some respects, but found him overbearing and dogmatic in other respects. So I worked on ecology and there was Gandhi. I worked on Elwin and there was Gandhi. Then I wrote a book on cricket called A Corner of a Foreign Field, which is a social history of cricket in India, which revolves around a family of Dalit cricketers, the Palwankar brothers, who were arguably the greatest Indian cricketers before we became a test playing nation, but never got the recognition they deserved because of their caste. And Gandhi actually had no interest in cricket. I mean, Gandhi had been interested in many things, but in many ways, he was a little bit of a Philistine. He never watched Hindi films, for example. There's only a record of his watching one film, and I'm told he went to sleep halfway. And he had virtually no interest in sport. He had a limited interest in music, if the music communicated ideas of spiritual harmony and tolerance. So he admired Tagore's poetry, and he was happy for Tagore to sing, but I doubt he could have sung in tune along with Tagore. So it was more the sentiments of what Tagore was doing. Right. So Gandhi was, I mean, he was an extraordinary person. I mean, in many ways, the greatest person of modern time, not just India. I mean, I think the greatest global figure in the last 200 or 300 years. But he was not interested in cricket. But although he had no interest in cricket per se, he influenced the politics of cricket. The Dalit brothers whom I was writing about were disregarded and unrecognized till Gandhi's supporters brought to the cricket field Gandhi's ideas that caste was and untouchability were obnoxious. So even when writing about cricket, ostensibly a field that Gandhi had no interest in, his influence was all pervasive. And the index to my cricket book had 40 entries to Gandhi, although he never played cricket or watched cricket. Although I was not a Gandhiwala, I was more of a Nehruwala growing up. As someone, one encountered Gandhi in the school textbooks, in the hagiography of the national movement, you know, every 2nd October and 30th January, one had to observe what he did. So some of the basic facts about Gandhi's life, every Indian of your generation of mine knew. I mean, now it may be changing. I mean, maybe it's possible, I hope not, but God forbid it's possible that we'll have a generation of younger Indians who know more about Godse than they know about Gandhi. But so I knew the basic, but the nuances and the details I did not know. So very quickly, I mean, if I was to say, what are the new things I learned about Gandhi, new and interesting things I learned about Gandhi? I think what was his extraordinary capacity for friendship. People in public life, people who are incredibly successful, normally do not have close friends. I don't believe our prime minister has a single close friend. I'm not sure if Mukesh Ambani has a close friend. All right. Or a top cricketer has a close friend, you know, Rafael Nadal, or tennis player, because they're so consumed by their career and success. It's a full-time thing. This is not a judgment. It's not a pejorative judgment. It's a factual observation. People who are incredibly driven, successful, full-time, rarely have close friendships. Gandhi had an amazing capacity for friendship. Across the racial, the religious, and even the gender divide, and even the generational divide. So that is, and I think that's why my books are peopled with his encounters with all kinds of, and his friendships and relationships with all kinds of people in England, South Africa, and all parts of India. The second, I think, in a sense, among the many other things I learned about Gandhi, the second thing I'd like to highlight in our conversation, Sudeep, was his ability to grow, develop, learn from his mistakes, and open and enlarge his mind. If you look at, for example, his attitudes towards race, when he goes to South Africa as a young man, he's a racist because he's in his early 20s, and Indians were then, and to some extent still are, racist. You know, skin color is very important to them. Indians tend to regard Europeans as advanced, Indians as catching up with the Europeans, and Africans somewhere behind. So Gandhi was a typical young middle-class Indian in his racist views, but he outgrew them. And he shed them by the time he left South Africa. He was a non-racist. He respected the Africans. He still would not associate with them politically because he thought the Indian struggle was different and distinct from the African struggle, but there were no longer racist remarks or racist thoughts in his mind. He comes back to India and he becomes a proper universalist. And for the last 30 years of his life, he's advocating interracial solidarity. Great civil rights leaders such as in the United States, like W.E.B. Du Bois and Howard Thurman, are in correspondence with him. Thurman, in fact, comes in to see him. So the evolution of his views on race, the evolution of his views on caste, again, is a very interesting phenomenon. He grew up, of course, with the class prejudice, any upper caste Hindu, Baniya would, of the time. He then recognized the pernicious evil that untouchability was. But while saying untouchability was evil, he still retained an idealized picture of the caste system as somehow organic and necessary for India. He was hesitant to prescribe intermixing, interdining. But then when confronted with the challenge of more radical reformers like the great Malayali thinker, Sri Narayana Guru, and then B.R. Ambedkar, when confronted with the challenge of Narayana Guru and Ambedkar, he became more and more radical in his thinking on caste. Likewise with gender, you know, he was a Hindu patriarch, and it took him a long time to think of women as active agents who could shape and make their own lives. But again, it was his willingness to debate and dialogue. So this is linked to his ability to have personal relationships. So in the case of caste, it's reasonably well known that people like Narayana Guru and especially Ambedkar broadened Gandhi's mind through the arguments with Gandhi. But how his thinking on gender was shaped by women around him is less known. I mean, in his autobiography, he talks about Kasturba. But much more important than Kasturba are two European women he met in South Africa, Millie Pollack, who was married to Gandhi's close friend and associate Henry Pollack, and Gandhi's old secretary, an extraordinary Jewish woman called Sonia Schlesing, who were continuously challenging and confronting Gandhi on his patriarchal prejudices. Then he comes back to India, and the role that Sonia Schlesing and Millie Pollack, these two European women, had played in South Africa in trying to make Gandhi less patriarchal is carried forward by two remarkable Indian women, Sarojini Naidu and Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay. And you know, he was hesitant for women to join the freedom struggle. You know, the salt march happened. He said, okay, you can picket the liquor store, but you can't make salt. And Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay said, no, we are doing it. Women will be part of this movement. And she literally, you know, forced Gandhi's hand. So I think all of us find it very hard to acknowledge mistakes. Mm-hmm. Most of us are the prisoners of prejudices we have embraced in our early adulthood, not in our youth, but our formative years, 20s and 30s. We don't shed it. That's why, you know, those who are youthful Marxists remain dogmatic leftists to the end. Those who join the RSS in their 20s, despite all the horrors they experience, never leave it. But Gandhi's ability to change, transform, and always in a more progressive, more open-minded, more tolerant, more egalitarian direction, through his encounters with people and his willingness to learn with them, debate with them, and change his mind if necessary. So these are two, of course, among the things I learned. A third, and I end with that. I'll end that very briefly, since both you and me are writers, is what a wonderfully clear and direct writer Gandhi was. There were no stylistic flourishes. There was no drawing attention to how clever I am, how fancy the language I use. Look at this trick I have used. Look at this very fancy phrase I have put in. Look at this allusion from Latin that I've thrown into my prose. None of that. He was a direct, straightforward writer, a lot like Orwell in that regard.
Well, that's
so
wonderful, Ram.
I more as a writer too. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Ram, it's interesting that you mentioned this because it's and from something that you've written about and talked about previously. I take it that Gandhi was also greatly challenged and interrogated by people like B.R. Ambedkar on the one hand, and the expectations of the Hindu right of his time, even pre-independence Hindu right of his time, when he was sort of, I think you mentioned once that they were caught, he was sort of caught in between. And then on the as a sort of a Trishanku, as a sort of a third element, he had Swaraj to handle as well, to balance as well. So could you, talk about how this other interrogative aspect, this other challenge or these other challenges also were pivots in Gandhi's life and therefore, in a way, pivots in modern Indian history.
So, absolutely. So, you know, when you think of caste, Ambedkar was impatient with Gandhi, thinking Gandhi is going too slow in trying to reform the caste system. But the Hindu right, the Hindu priesthood, the Sankaracharyas, the custodians of Hindu orthodoxy, that Gandhi was a dangerous radical going too fast, upturning the social order, that the scriptures had sanctioned caste distinctions, that the scriptures had placed untouchables beyond the pale because of alleged sins they'd committed in their last life. So this is something which young left-wing critics of Gandhi today don't recognize. That Gandhi's most dangerous opponents were the Hindu right. Because in the 1920s, in a deeply conservative society, to confront and challenge their religious prejudices, you know, and to say, no, untouchability is morally wrong. Even if somewhere in the scriptures it is justified, it cannot be defended on ethical grounds. As if, as he says, as Gandhi often said, we will not be fit for Swaraj unless we have abolished untouchability. Here was Gandhi and the Congress leading a movement for freedom from European colonial rule. But what moral right had Indians to demand freedom from Europeans when they were repressing and suppressing a large section of their own society? So in Gandhi's vision, I mean, there's a lovely image from Gandhi that I'll just briefly share, which comes from the non-cooperation movement, which occurred exactly 100 years ago, 1920-21, which was the first major mass movement against colonial rule that Gandhi led. And during the non-cooperation movement, Gandhi defined Swaraj. And he had a beautiful image of Swaraj. He said, Swaraj is like a bed. So just imagine this glass as a bed with four posts, four pillars. And these four pillars are non-violence, Hindu-Muslim harmony, abolition of untouchability, and the promotion of khaddar, which is, you know, economic dignity and welfare of the abolition of poverty. So Swaraj is like a bed with four sturdy posts, non-violence, Hindu-Muslim harmony, abolition of untouchability, and the promotion of khaddar. If you review one post, the whole structure will crumble. So if you have a bed with four posts, if three posts are robust and one is insecure or eaten up by termites, as would happen in Goa quite often where you are in the monsoon, that you'd have wood eaten up by termites, the whole bed will collapse. So the extraordinary thing about Gandhi was he was not just a freedom fighter. Those around him, many of the radicals around him, who were his predecessors like Tilak or people younger than him, like Bhagat Singh, said, we have to get the British the hell out of here, and after that we'll attend to our own problems. Gandhi said, no, we have to attend to our own problems simultaneously. We have to improve and reform and transform our own society before we are fit for freedom from British rule. And his emphasis on Hindu-Muslim harmony was extremely relevant at the time and is even more relevant today, that India's two largest communities must find a way of getting along companionably, because otherwise there will be fratricidal civil war.
Ram, when we take it from there, and you know the various pillars that you mentioned and the various pivots and fulcrums that you mentioned, which led Gandhi to take on issues as he did and fight for those issues as he did, compromise, step back, step ahead, sort of a chess game, if you will, during the sort of the pre-independence era. And many of these have carried over to post-independence India, including in the beginning, at least in the early days of India, and there seems to be a sort of a lip service resurgence of it. For instance, the rural economy that Mohandas Gandhi propagated as well. And here I'd like to bring up another thing that I recall you saying some years ago, or writing, if I'm not wrong, when you talked about using and abusing Gandhi, you know, the use and abuse of Gandhi as a sort of a motive, as a symbol, as a name, beyond just the several roads that are named after him. So how has he shaped modern India, if you take it from all these fulcrums and pillars and pivots that we've just discussed, which we've talked about so eloquently, and you talked about and you take it ahead to the sort of the lip service, if you will, where Mohandas Gandhi is on our money. Mohandas Gandhi is the face of Swachh Bharat. Mohandas Gandhi is NREGA, are the most preeminent rural employment generation program. So could you take us, could you talk a little bit about these pivots and this sort of evolution as well, in sort of the use and abuse of Gandhi, if you will, in the making of modern India, and in fact, in modern India. Would you like to share your thoughts about that?
Yeah, so, you know, Sudeep, you know, all our arguments are with Gandhi. Mm-hmm. You know, so with Gandhi in both senses, using Gandhi, sometimes misusing Gandhi, or against Gandhi. So one of the interesting things about Gandhi today, almost 75 years after he died, is that in the West, he's broadly admired as a person of principle, courage, decency. Maybe we'll talk about it a little later, but his environmental precociousness is also something that is now recognized and admired around the world. But in India, he remains very alive as a figure of contention and debate. Mm-hmm. So the Hindu right detests him. So does the Maoist left. You know, the Naxalite movement, which started in the late 60s and is still active in some parts of Central Eastern India. This is an area you know well. I mean, you've traveled in Bastar and written about these conflicts. The Naxalites hate Gandhi even more venomously than the Hindu Mahasabha. In 1969, to the time of the Gandhi centenary, they demolished the statues. That's what they tried to do. So many left-wing intellectuals, you know, dislike Gandhi, right-wing activists abhor Gandhi. Modernists find him a somewhat sort of prissy, puritanical figure. They mock his alleged glorification of the rural economy. They don't like his emphasis on the simple life. So what is fascinating is what a figure of debate and argument and disputation he remains. Now, every government pays lip service to Gandhi. Mm-hmm. You know, so it is lip service. That's the phrase you use. So Manmohan Singh, who was prime minister for 10 years, every second October, he would go to Rajghat if he was in town. And he would sit for a minute, fold his hands, close his eyes, and maybe really think of Gandhi for that 1 minute, but that's it. You know, for the rest, there would be the naming of the flagship rural employment program after Gandhi. But there would be no transparency. There would be no dignity. There would be no moral courage shown in what Manmohan Singh and his government was doing. Likewise with Modi. Now, Modi also will pay lip service to Gandhi, and the spectacles of Gandhi are in Swachh Bharat. Now, clearly, cleanliness and sanitation were aspects of Gandhi's work, but so was Hindu-Muslim harmony, which Gandhi will never talk about, Modi will never talk about. So was transparency and dialogue, which Modi will never talk about. In 6.5 years as prime minister, Modi has never held a press conference. Gandhi held a press conference almost every day when he was politically active, right? So the government in power feels obliged for whatever reason to pay lip service to Gandhi. But in civil society as a whole, there's an intense and active debate around Gandhi's legacy. Sometimes very polemical, sometimes not very productive, but often very, very interesting. I mean, the fact is that who else 75 years after he left would inspire such strong emotions, pro and con? You know, and I think that's in some ways is a tribute to that Gandhi's asking us tough questions. He's asking us questions that are still relevant. How do we treat untouchables? How do we overcome the boundaries between high caste and low caste? How do we develop individual self-reliance? How do we promote interfaith harmony? How do we conduct ourselves in public with a certain dignity and rectitude? So I think these are things that Gandhi still asks of us, and often we come short. Often we don't recognize what he's asking of us. So we misunderstand him or mock him. But, you know, it's like, but he is present in almost every debate in India as a frame of reference, not necessarily as a frame of affirmation, but as the frame of reference and context.
Well, if so, in many ways, he does resonate, whether for better and worse, in a contentious way and not even to this very day in India, the country of his belonging, the country that he really adopted and he gave his life for in a way. But you know, when you look at, and something that you referred to earlier, when you look at how Gandhi is perceived across the world, yeah, he seems to resonate in a very unifying manner. I mean, there doesn't seem to be too much dissonance across the world in how the sort of the Gandhi tuning fork resonates. He seems to be almost universally accepted as a certain symbol of peace, of affirmation, of so many values. Could you discuss a little bit about that, please?
So I'll just illustrate this point with reference to the cover of Gandhi Before India. Now, you can see the cover. It's of a very unusual portrait, not the portrait of Gandhi Indians associate with the man, because he's not in a loincloth, he has no spectacles, he has a suit and a tie. All right. Now, I was in a hotel in New York, and my copy of my book was on the table. And a waiter came in to, I'd ordered some room service. He came to collect the room service, and he looked at this cover, and he said, that's the young Mr. Gandhi, isn't it? He had no idea it was my book. He just saw this photograph. He said, that's the young Mr. Gandhi, isn't it? I said, yes. Then he said, in our country, we greatly admire him. So I asked the waiter, what is your country, sir? He said, the Dominican Republic. Okay. Now, Gandhi was, as I've said earlier, Gandhi was not a particularly aesthetic person. He also didn't have a deep knowledge of geography or history. Gandhi may not have known what the Dominican Republic was. He never came within 5,000 miles of the Dominican Republic. But here is Gandhi, venerated in the Dominican Republic, so that a working class Dominican working in New York can recognize the young Mr. Gandhi. Right now, so that's a sign of how far his fame traveled. And even in a pre-internet age, I mean, in my biography, I talk about how in the 20s and 30s, Gandhi's work is discussed in America, in Africa, in Europe, in Argentina, and all across in Eastern Europe, Poland, Hungary, and all across the world. However, in recent years, early racism has come under scrutiny in Africa. And some young African radicals have gone hammer at tongs at Gandhi because of his early racism, that he was a racist when he was young is undeniable, but that he outgrew his racism is equally important. And unfortunately, some of these young radicals don't recognize it because, you know, it's the iconoclast. Young people want to debunk heroes, that comes naturally to youthful, a kind of youthful radicalism. But as a scholar, I would urge them to be more attentive to the truth and the nuances of Gandhi's own life and examine how, not just how he was a racist when he was young, but how he overcame, which is a salutary and inspiring story. But in the West, in many parts of Asia, Gandhi is admired for for his moral courage, for his principle, for the simplicity of his life, for the openness of his life. You know, that unlike other political leaders, he doesn't live behind a security blanket. He doesn't go in a motorcade of bulletproof cars. He, you know, doesn't fly in an aircraft that is reserved for him alone. So I think all this is something that appeals to Gandhi, appeals to Westerners and foreigners about Gandhi, not just a person in the Dominican Republic, but Barack Obama. I mean, the contemporary politician who repeatedly expresses his admiration for Gandhi is Barack Obama. Even in his latest memoir, there's a whole page on Gandhi, which is full of praise, which the Indian press didn't pick up. They instead picked up the two sentences which were disparaging about Rahul Gandhi. All right, but not the whole paragraph, page, which was about Mahatma Gandhi. So Obama's admiration for Gandhi is of long standing. It's not fashionable or mere lip service, to use your phrase. When he was a young community organizer in Chicago, Obama had five portraits on his, I think, in his study. There was Martin Luther King, Nelson Mandela, Thurgood Marshall, the first Black Supreme Court Justice, Lincoln, and Gandhi. Now, I think these were the five, or maybe Lincoln was not there, there were only four, but Gandhi was kind of there in Obama's study when he was in his 20s and 30s. If you look at the whole environmental movement, you know, the climate change campaigners, they are greatly inspired by Gandhi and what he stood for. Movements for nonviolence, we know his influence on the civil rights struggle led by Dr. Martin Luther King, but much less well known is that movements like solidarity were inspired by Gandhi.
Lech Walesa in Poland.
In Poland. Yes. So the non-violent struggle against the Soviet totalitarian regime was also inspired by Gandhi. So that's, you know, it's, I mean, no one since the Buddha, no South Asian figure since the Buddha. I almost called the Buddha an Indian figure, but then the Nepalese may dispute it. So no South Asian figure since the Buddha has had that kind of worldwide influence.
In fact, it's quite interesting, Ram, when you mentioned the four names, the portraits of the people that President Obama had on his desk when he wasn't president, he was just a young politician on the go. They were all influenced by Gandhi. I mean, yes. Mandela himself, you're talking about Martin Luther King,
right.
And of course, you know, all the others that you took the names of, except for Mr. Lincoln, of course,
yeah.
You know, who in a way inspired Gandhi in some ways, I'm told, in a sort of a interesting twist. So, you know, it's sort of Gandhi all around. Now here, I like the refreshing approach because, Ram, you look at Gandhi as a person, as a human being, as a man, just a man. I mean, you talk about him as just one of us who was an extraordinary man in his own way in extraordinary times, and he lived through them and he created them in some ways. Now, how much was Gandhi's, it's a strange question perhaps, but let me ask it anyway. How much was Gandhi's innate showmanship, if you will, which perhaps was born of his training as a lawyer and his long practice as a lawyer, and then his engagement with the civil rights movement in Southern Africa, and then the melding of the two expertises when he comes over to India in the early part of the 20th century? And how does this sort of, this aptitude for debate, this aptitude for public presence, his aptitude for public presentation, legalese, his command presence, if you will, or his ability to deal with different situations and different people, become a pivot in Gandhi's life, his approach, and therefore become a pivot in what effectively is the leading up to the Swaraj and effectively the making of modern India? How much of a showman really was Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi?
So that's an interesting question. In some respects, he was not a showman at all. Mm-hmm. For example, it is oratory.
Mm-hmm.
If we see the few videos of Gandhi speaking,
mm-hmm.
He has a very understated low voice. When there's a camera, he's actually looking down. He's not even looking at the camera. So he was not a showman in the way Trump or Modi are showmen, right? He didn't have a loud voice. He didn't mock his opponents. He didn't ask other people to get out of the frame so that the camera would focus only on him. But I think the symbolism of what he was doing, I think he was a showman in his methods of dress. You know, mm-hmm. Again, to go back to this picture, mm-hmm. the way he abandoned this for the loincloth.
Mm-hmm.
And what that said, I mean, there's a wonderful book by the British anthropologist M.R. Tarlow, which is a great chapter on Gandhi and clothing. You know, how he went from wearing a suit to wearing a turban to wearing virtually nothing at all. Right. Now, so I think at the idioms he used. So again, you know, the idioms he used, if you just think of that image of Swaraj as a bedpost with four pillars, it's a profoundly, it's an all-encompassing image. It's a political manifesto in 20 words.
Mm-hmm.
So he was able to communicate directly, simply, and also in Indian languages. One of the great innovations, mm-hmm. political innovations Gandhi made was before he came back to India, the Congress Party operated in the language of the middle class, English. Gandhi said, no, some of our discussions can be in English, but the bulk of our discussions should be in Odia, Telugu, Marathi, Hindi, Kannada, Bengali, and so on. So the use of the vernacular, his use of magazines. You know, Gandhi was, among other things, an editor for 40 years.
Mm-hmm.
You have been an editor, but not for 40 years. I've been a full-time writer all my life, but I've not produced mm-hmm. one-fifth the volume of work Gandhi has, and he did much more than you and I in spheres other than mm-hmm. writing. So the value of the printed word. Today, it would be Twitter and Facebook and speeches, but and the printed word in many languages. So when he started a newspaper in South Africa, Indian Opinion, to promote the cause of Indians, that newspaper was printed in four languages, Tamil, Gujarati, and Hindi, because those are the three languages spoken in the diaspora, and English, so that you address the ruler as well. So, you know, a multilingual newspaper. I mean, I have not been able to confirm this, Sudeep, but you could, mm-hmm. since you're you've spent a lifetime in journalism, in print journalism. This may have been the first multilingual newspaper in the world. You have bilingual newspapers. For example, Tilak's newspaper Maratha was Marathi and English, but this was mm-hmm. four languages. So communication through the printed word And of course, we're talking about a time when, just as today, WhatsApp forwards go across, in those days, there'd be one educated person in the village who would read out Gandhi's editorial in Harijan to everyone in the village, the editorial in Hindi or in Gujarati or in English. So I think showman is the wrong word. Mm-hmm. I would say he was a great communicator. And he knew how to use language in a very simple yet subtle way. His allusions were homely but effective. The other great attribute he had as a political leader was that he was a team builder. So he was a great talent spotter, Sunil. If you look at what he did in India, he comes back in 1915. He travels around India for a year. And then he starts getting slowly active in politics. His first movement is in Champaran, where he meets two people who are to become his very close lieutenants, Rajendra Prasad, which is the first president of India, and Acharya J.B. Kriplani. Shortly after that, he meets Chakravarti Rajagopalachari in Tamil Nadu and draws him into the fold. Then he meets Vallabhai Patel in Gujarat. A little later, he travels to Allahabad and he finds Jawaharlal Nehru. And then, of course, Maulana Azad in Calcutta, and so on, Sarojini Naidu and Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay, and so on and so forth. So his, as a leader, one of his great attributes was simple and effective and direct communication. A second great attribute was that he was a team builder. He saw talent, stoked it, developed it, nurtured it. But showman would be the wrong one. Showman would be misleading and probably wrong. A great communicator, a wonderful writer, and a terrific organization person in terms of building a team.
Well, I take your point, Ram, and thank you for that. When you talk about the aspect of team building here, I wish to sort of flag a dissonance, if you will, at least in certain parts of India and among certain people in India, and not necessarily the right-wing Hindu lobby, if you will, which have sort of disagreed with Mohandas Gandhi almost forever since his arrival in India. Here I speak about Subhash Chandra Bose. When, you know, there is this enduring, feeling, for instance, in Bengal, and here I mean Greater Bengal and now primarily Western Bengal, or the Bangla sphere, as I like to call it, about how Mohandas Gandhi actually tripped Subhash Chandra Bose from a legitimate presidentship of the Indian National Congress, and because of his personal ego and or his personal feelings or his personal points of view, which differed with Subhash Chandra Bose's, or the fact that, you know, Subhash Bose was maybe a maverick and a person of his own making without being a Gandhivadi necessarily, or in many ways. And then the tripping up of Subhash Bose, or the Tripura Congress, and subsequent disillusionment of Subhash Chandra Bose, the perception that he propped up Jawaharlal Nehru in his place, and so on and so forth, has led to an enduring dissonance with Mohandas Gandhi in Bengal and among a large group of Bengalis, which sort of rides parallel with all the good things that they feel about Gandhi. Could you address a bit about that? Because this is a sort of there is no closure to this, almost like Subhash Bose's death. There is really no closure sometimes. There is no closure to this animosity, if you will, or this perceived animosity between Mohandas Gandhi, the great team builder, as you call him, and Subhash Bose, who was maybe a team builder, not as good a one as Mr. Gandhi, but I just wonder what your thoughts are about that.
No, I can. It's an important question. It requires a detailed answer. So hear me out. Mm-hmm. All right. Mm-hmm. Now, and it's comparable to what I said about Gandhi and race. Mm-hmm. Gandhi was an early racist, but he overcame that, shed that, transcended that. But those who are nitpicking will only take that early racism. Radical Africans will only take that and forget the rest of his life and what he thought and did on the question of race. Mm-hmm. Likewise with Subhash Bose. Mm-hmm. Bengalis, a certain kind of Bengali, will only take Gandhi's coercion, which led to Bose giving up the presidency of the Congress, and not forget what happened after that between Gandhi and Bose. Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm. Now, I mean, Bengalis had been deeply ambivalent towards Gandhi well before the Bose incident.
Right.
Before Gandhi came on the scene, Bengal was the epicenter of the national movement. And because of Gandhi, the epicenter shifted from Eastern India to Western India. And a certain kind of Bengali has not forgiven him for that. But the Bose incident is very, very, I mean, you know, one need to know the whole details. It is true that Gandhi used moral coercive power to get Bose to resign the presidency. Not because of an ego battle, but because of the question of principle. Bose was wavering in his commitment to violence. To non-violence. Unlike Gandhi always believed that the best, the most reliable, the most efficacious, and the most sustainable method to get the British out of India was non-violence. And Bose wanted to use violence. And Gandhi, I think, could not abide that. The members of the working committee, who were largely Gandhi loyalists, could not work with Bose, so that Bose had to leave. Right. Now, but what happened after that? Bose, this is the part of the Bose-Gandhi story, and even the Bose-Nehru story, that Bose devotees ignore or deliberately suppress. Since what happens after that? Bose flees to Afghanistan, goes to Germany, then lands up in Japan. Mm-hmm. Now, there are several questions here. First, Gandhi and Nehru believed that the British were less evil than Hitler. Bose did not see that. Maybe out of naivete or out of the logic that my enemy is my friend. But Gandhi and particularly Nehru clearly recognized that what the Japanese had done in China was 100 times worse than what the British had done in India. They were barbaric. So there was a major ideological reason for Gandhi and Nehru to be on different sides from Bose when it came to what you would do in the Second World War. But they were on the same side when it came to Hindu-Muslim harmony. Now, the Bose story is very interesting. The Bose-Gandhi story is like a son who has rebelled against the father, has been cast out of the house by the father, but is still somewhere loyal to the father. So Bose goes to Japan after Afghanistan and Italy, lands up in Singapore after the fall of Singapore, and takes over the Indian National Army, which was a rump till he took it over. And he forms four brigades. What are these brigades called? Gandhi Brigade, Nehru Brigade, Azad Brigade, and the fourth brigade, he succumbs to his own vanity, since you've been accusing Gandhi of egotism, Bose Brigade. But this is something you will never hear from the apologists of Bose today. Why did Bose name his brigades Gandhi, Nehru, and Azad? Because on most things, he was on the same side as Nehru and Gandhi. For 20 years, they had been part of the same non-violent struggle for freedom. And above all, like Nehru, like Gandhi, and totally unlike the BJP and the RSS, Bose was totally committed to Hindu-Muslim harmony. He hated the idea of a Hindu Rashtra. He would have detested what Modi and Shah are doing to India today, because he believed in complete religious equality. He also believed in gender equality, which is something he shared with Gandhi. Now move on further. The story does not end here. Some other very important historical facts that are left out by those who pose this false opposition between Gandhi and Bose. So here is Bose with the Indian National Army. The brigades are named Gandhi, Nehru, and Azad Brigade. Gandhi launches the Quit India movement. He is jailed along with Nehru and Patel and Azad and everybody else. On 2nd October 1943, Gandhi's 75th birthday, 74th birthday, but 75th by the Indian custom, because we count the birthday to the day you were born. On that day, Bose gives an address on Azad Hind Radio. And the address is, he's addressing Gandhi, whom he calls Father of the Nation. Now, I've quoted this address in my book. It's a beautiful address. He says, Father of the Nation. That's the first time that phrase is used by Gandhi, by none other than his alleged opponent, Subhash Chandra Bose. Father of the Nation. And he goes on in that address to talk about how Gandhi nurtured the struggle for independence, how he gave young Indians hope, courage, and fortitude, and how he's carrying on that struggle. And he will not end that struggle that Gandhi began till the British left. So he's called Father of the Nation. Then what happens after that? Bose dies in 1945. Gandhi is in jail from 42 to 44. The Bengal famine happens while Gandhi is in jail. When Gandhi comes out of jail, Bose dies, Gandhi goes to Bengal. And he meets Bose's followers of the Indian National Army. The next year, the riots happen in Noakhali. Gandhi goes on a pilgrimage of peace. Who is accompanying Gandhi on the pilgrimage of peace? Some of the most remarkable followers of Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. There's a man, this is all there in my book. There's an IRA officer called Sardar Niranjan Singh Gill, who gets a group of Sardars to march with Gandhi from village to village, and because they are Sardars and tough and pragmatic, to take the provisions, erect the tents, dismantle the tents, go to the next village. Here are former members of the IRA who knew Bose, worked with Bose, marching with Gandhi for Hindu-Muslim harmony. From there, Gandhi goes to Bihar to promote Hindu-Muslim harmony. And here his closest associate is another INA officer, General Shahnawaz Khan. So that's the true story of the relationship between Gandhi and Bose. It's very deep, very complex, very abiding. And as Gandhi said in 1946, Subhash and I disagreed on the question of violence, but on everything else, we were on the same side. Now that is the truth about Gandhi and Bose. Now, one last thing about Nehru and Bose. Nehru and Bose were also on the same side on many things. Rudranshu's, Mukherjee's book, Nehru and Bose, shows this. And after Nehru became prime minister, he arranged a government pension for Bose's widow in Austria. And he appointed several members of the IRA, including Niranjan Singh Gill, to the Indian Foreign Service. So these are false and dishonest oppositions that have been created between Nehru and Bose. Nehru and Gandhi, they had disagreements on certain organizational matters, on certain policy matters, but in the most important questions, they were on the same side.
Well, Ram, wonderful. Here I would like to bring up a sort of another extant issue, which is basically the myth and the reality, if you will, of Mohandas Gandhi's relationship, or the lack of it, with the burgeoning Hindu right almost immediately after his arrival in India, and which continued in sort of opposition to him through several years. And how would Mohandas Gandhi, I mean, I ask this question because there is a sort of a approach to muscular politics of today, and there is almost a yearning to make Gandhi a muscle man, or a hope that Gandhi was a muscle man or a superman like a Patel or an X or a Y. You know, there is this sort of, so in that particular context, when there's sort of yearning to perhaps make more of Gandhi than he was, and on the other side, you have a situation where the Hindutva behemoth ultimately took his life. So here you have a sort of extant dissonance, which is decades and decades in the making and continues to this day. So could you talk about the myth and reality of Mohandas Gandhi's relationship with the Hindu right?
Gandhi was absolutely opposed to the idea of a Hindu Rashtra. He was totally against thinking of India as a homeland for Hindus. Pakistan had been created as a homeland for Muslims, which was bad enough because the Hindus and Sikhs had been driven out of particularly the western part of Pakistan. And Gandhi was determined that everyone in India would be an equal citizen regardless of the religion they practiced. He would be totally opposed to the Citizenship Amendment Act. And the reason I came out in protest against that act was as a biographer of Gandhi as much as an Indian. And I was, it was so moving to see the portraits of Gandhi held up there. And the slogans from Gandhi about Hindu-Muslim harmony, you know, the stigmatization of Muslims that is particularly visible in Northern India. You know, the police is communalized. Sections of the judiciary are communalized. Large sections of the population are communalized. You know, Muslims can't get houses to rent. They won't get job opportunities and so on and so forth. They're discriminated against in every sphere of life and directly aided by the ruling party in Delhi. And Gandhi would have been appalled because this is really what he stood against. If there's anything Gandhi wanted in his last months, it was that India should never be a Hindu Pakistan. So the Hindu right has absolutely no claim on Gandhi. And deep down inside, they actually detest Gandhi. The only person who kind of triangulates, if you will, is Narendra Modi. Because he recognizes Gandhi is a global figure. We can't repudiate him. We can't disavow him. So when Pragya Thakur says that Nathuram Godse is a Desh Bhakt, Narendra Modi says, I won't forgive her, but I don't know what that means. He keeps on saying various kinds of inflammatory and nasty things, right? And with to great acclaim among her party men, you know. So Godse Bhaks vastly outnumber Gandhi Bhaks in the Sangh Parivar. That's a brutal fact. That's a brutal fact. But they know it's impolite to acknowledge it. They know it's bad for the image if they make the dislike of Gandhi public. So they pretend, no, Gandhi was really a Hindu. No, he was somewhere on our same side. We can use part of our parivar in a broader sense. But these are all, it's not just dissembling, it is plain lies. I mean, I have quoted in a recent article in the Telegraph, Gandhi saying the RSS is a communal body with a totalitarian outlook. That's what Gandhi thought of the RSS. A communal body with a totalitarian outlook. That's what they remain. And that's what Gandhi would have said about them today if he were alive.
Yeah. Ram, just a quick question about Gandhi. You know, I'm using the trope of the two of your fine books. You know, one is Gandhi before India, and the other is India after Gandhi. But what about Gandhi after India? In the sense, and I'm not being facetious, but I just wonder how Gandhi changed. I mean, after he arrived in India, how did India change Gandhi? It's something that people don't always address. I mean, there is surely that facet to his life as well.
So I think, you know, India changed Gandhi, but before I come to that, let me say a little bit about what the diaspora did to Gandhi. The diaspora made Gandhi Indian. You know, before Gandhi went to South Africa, he tried to establish himself as a lawyer in Bombay and in Rajkot. So he comes back from London with a law degree, and like many Gujarati lawyers before and since, tries to leverage his London qualification towards professional success in Bombay and fails. Now, here's a thought experiment. What if Gandhi had succeeded as a lawyer in Bombay? Maybe we would not have been having this conversation because it would have been a very different India. He would have been a successful lawyer. Most of his clients would have been Gujaratis. Maybe many of them would have been Baniyas. He would have spoken Gujarati at home, in the court, in the restaurant, on the street, and he'd have been remained trapped in his parochialism of his upbringing. He goes to South Africa and he becomes an Indian because his first client is a Muslim, a Gujarati, but a Muslim. Yet when he starts his satyagraha, his first patron is a Parsi. When the satyagraha is floundering, it is rescued by the Tamils. So the linguistic and religious diversity of India, Gandhi understands only in the diaspora. But he, as you say, he is a successful lawyer in the diaspora, which he wasn't here. He comes back to India and starts traveling around. I mean, the best piece of advice Gokhale, anyone could give, almost anyone could give a young apprentice is what Gokhale told Gandhi. Keep your mouth shut for a year on politics, despite all that you've done in South Africa, and just travel around India and know the countryside. So before Gandhi travels around India in 1915, he's never spoken to a peasant or a worker or a mazdoor or a kisan or an artisan or a shilpkar, but he gets to know the desperate poverty of India. And he acquaints himself at first hand with the extraordinary linguistic, religious, cultural, geographical diversity of India. And he declasses himself. And he declasses the Congress Party, as I've said, and he makes sure it operates in the vernacular and no longer remains confined to lawyers and doctors and teachers, but embraces the subaltern underclasses of Indian society. So India transforms him, makes him a truly mass leader, and he at the same time, he's changing his views. As I said earlier in our conversation, Sudeep, it's by encountering people like Narayana Guru and Ambedkar in India that he becomes more radical in his approach to caste. It's early Indian feminists like Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay who broaden his ideas on gender, and his even his whole approach to technology changes. Many people who write on Gandhi mistakenly see his early book, Hind Swaraj, as a kind of first and last word of his views on development and modernity. So Hind Swaraj is full of, you know, kind of almost Luddite anti-modern statements that we don't need doctors, we don't need lawyers. But he has adopts a much more nuanced attitude towards science and technology, a much more pragmatic attitude by coming back to India and meeting, you know, scientists like C.V. Raman and others, right? So, you know, But it's, again, the capacity to learn, to keep your ears and eyes open, never to think your thought is finished, you know, always to eschew certitude. The only thing Gandhi was dogmatic about, there were two things he was dogmatic about: Hindu-Muslim harmony and non-violence. If I have a dispute with you, I will resolve it peacefully. I will not take a gun and shoot you. And there will be no religious discrimination. On all other things, he was prepared to change his mind. And that's what he did all through his 30-odd years in India.
Well, Ram, to move a little away from Mohandas Gandhi, if you will, but not in an unrelated manner, when you look at, you know, because of his great overarching influence on pre-independence history of India and post-independence history of India as well, and ongoing history on the make as we speak, what are the, you know, could you share your thoughts about what other pivots and highlights you see as being, as contributing to the making of modern India in terms of personalities, people, or in terms of events as well? If you just moved away from the, you know, the pivot of Gandhi.
So in, you know, in for convenience, let me just focus on personalities. Right. So, you know, I have a book, Makers of Modern India, which has the anthology of writing of 19 great individuals. And, you know, I've spoken about Ambedkar. I've spoken about Nehru. I think a truly great person in India's national renaissance was Rabindranath Tagore. And unfortunately, he's been parochialized by the Bengalis. You know, Ravi Shankar, the great musician, once said, "We Bengalis have kept Tagore so close to our heart, we've not let the world see his greatness." I think that's very true. You know, he's been reduced to being a Bengali figure. And maybe, of course, his truly appreciate his poetry, you have to know the language. But his thought is universal. You know, his little book, Nationalism, is something which every world leader should read today. You know, his extraordinary moral courage in standing up against destructive nationalism. Again, like Gandhi, his capacity for friendships all across the world. You know, his building of institutions. So I think Tagore is someone, and Tagore is a great inspiration on Gandhi and on Bose and on Nehru. Actually, Tagore that way is a common thread between Nehru, Bose and Gandhi, because all are deeply inspired by Tagore. Then I'd say, well before Ambedkar, the great Jyotibai and Savitribai Phule, so, you know, radical anti-caste reformers in the Pune in the 1860s and 1870s, starting a school for women in conservative Pune in the middle of the 19th century. You know, again, very, very important individuals. So many, many great people of that time, any different parts of India, you know, in different Periyar. Again, someone who was a great, who's known mostly for his anti-Brahminical polemics and less known for his precocious advocacy of gender equality and contraception, that a woman must have control over her own body. I mean, Gandhi, to his shame, was opposed contraception. But Periyar knew that a woman must have, should have control over her own body. And so I think Periyar, so many such people in the independence, early independence period, much more admirable than the icons of the present regime like Savarkar, who are polarizing figures. You know, here are people who are looking within, who know that India needs self-correction. Rammohan Roy, I mean, the first great Indian liberal. I mean, if you read Rammohan Roy's writings on the freedom of the press of the 1820s, they're relevant to the 2020s today, right? So I think Gandhi was, and Gandhi is building on all of them. You know, Gopal Krishna Gokhale, his mentor, you know, he's built Tagore, he's building on all of them, and in some ways trying to incorporate the best of all that they represent. So I'd say there's a whole galaxy of extraordinary thinkers, activists, reformers produced in India from the early 19th century, and I've only taken a few names. I mean, people will complain that, you know, I've not mentioned people from Andhra Pradesh or from Orissa or whatever else, and that's, but there's a kind of ferment everywhere in the, and it's to do with the encounter with the West. What, again, you know, this xenophobia that we are all now subject to today, that we don't, can't learn from anyone outside India. our encounter with the West challenged us. You know, when the British came, they colonized us. They had more political power, more military power, more scientific knowledge. And also, they had better education. They were more open-minded about things like, individual rights. They denied it to us, but they had gave it to their own citizens. All these provoked and challenged Indians to reform themselves. I mean, this is a great statement of Karl Marx, which is kind of not very widely talked about, where he talks about the British impact on India. And I'm quoting from memory. He says, the British conquered India through the vilest of motives. Okay, so the motives were why they wanted to exploit and control and dominate India and use our economic resources. The British conquered India through the vilest of motives, but yet they were an unconscious tool of history because they brought Indians. I mean, India was an ossified, stagnant, traditional culture that had no capacity for self-renewal or innovation or self-criticism. And the British brought us face to face with the world that was changing. And it's the greatest, to the credit of people like Tagore and Ramon Roy and Phule, that they accepted the challenge. You know, Phule's book, Ghulam Gari, which is a book on slavery, is dedicated to Lincoln. So in the 1860s, a Maharashtrian, a lower caste Maharashtrian knows about Lincoln and knows how he can relate Lincoln's struggle to his struggle. Just as Obama today knows about Gandhi and can relate Gandhi's struggle to his struggle. That is true universalism, not this, Hindus are great. Hindus don't need to learn from anyone. We invented the zero. We know everything. We will dominate the world. We will be Vishwa Guru. All this kind of supremacist, triumphalist nonsense that is bruited about today. They should read Phule. They should read Tagore. They should read Ram Mohan Roy. They should read Vivekananda. They should read Ambedkar. And they should read Gandhi.
I think, Ram, that's a wonderful way to end this conversation. Thank you so very much for taking the time out to be with LifeHistoryIndia.com and its initiative, The Making of Modern India. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sure you've agreed that this has been a brilliant exposition by Dr. Ramchandra Guha. Thank you very much again, Ram.
Thank you.
Have a good evening. Have a good day.